So folks, you might be wondering what is Industry 4.0, and it dates back to 1800s, where Industrial Revolution actually started with the steam engines coming into picture and making the life of the humans easy. And then Industry 2.0 came into picture, which further made life more and more easy because of electricity. And electricity has led to creation of division of labor as well as mass production. And if you talk about 3.0, it's more about the IT systems, which are automating the production lines further. And have you heard about Industry 4.0? In case if you haven't heard about Industry 4.0, let's dive deep into it. Hello. Hi there. Welcome to the Guiding Voice podcast series, The Guiding Voice for a Better Future. This podcast is to help professional students, IT employees, and entrepreneurs to shape their careers. Dear listeners, in every episode, we interact with industry experts or leaders or academicians or coaches across the globe to drive some insightful conversations that will help each one of you learn wonderful things. Also, we share an interesting trivia or a fun fact around the IT world or technology towards the end. Thank you for tuning in. This is Naveen Samala and I'm with my co-host Sudhakar Naganla. So folks, as mentioned, today we are going to discuss a very, very important and interesting topic, Industry 4.0, Digital Smart Manufacturing. And we are pleased to welcome Sam to our show.
Sam Wadekar is a techno sales passionate leader leading the digital smart manufacturing vertical at Tata Technologies Europe, managing the Europe and North American geographies. He is based out of Warwick, UK, in the city of the Royal Leamington Spa. He's an entrepreneur, executive advisor with passion in building connected products, services, and businesses in the field of manufacturing. An engineer by training, a global strategist by vocation, and a marketer at heart. Multidisciplinary and multicultural background, pioneering the niche but very disruptive domain of digital smart manufacturing, leveraging Industry 4.0 using the new age technologies built over the robust ISA 95 stack. Sam is typical clientele would be customers from the automotive or manufacturing domain, implementing smart manufacturing for their manufacturing plants with a geographical footprint and interested in standardization across the enterprise and optimize production and ultimately, of course, saving the cost. Sam, thanks for taking your time. We really appreciate it. Welcome to our show.
Thank you. Thank you guys for having me on your show. Pleasure talking to Naveen, you and Sudhakar. And I like what you guys are doing and very excited to be a part of this journey with you guys. Thanks.
Pleasure is all ours, Sam. Can we get started?
Yes, please.
Excellent. So Sam, you know, we know about your multidisciplinary, multi-hats that you wear over the period of last 20, 21 years. So can we talk about your career journey? You know, you have been associated with some real big brands, right? You know, Stellantis, Bentley, John Deere, Jaguar, Land Rover, and Tata Motors, and that too across geographies.
That is true. So yeah, so a little bit of myself, as I said, with 22 years of experience, but with a very specific niche of being 10 years into hardcore manufacturing, most probably in the field of domain of automotive, and then 10 years in implementing IT solutions into manufacturing. So this kind of is a unique combination, if I say so. So I did start off as an entrepreneur in a family-owned company of mine back in 1998 after graduating. And then moved to the master's for my master's in the US to University of Michigan, Oakland campus in Michigan. And then while at my master's, I did work with Bentley Automotive, a German company, for a couple of years doing automotive product launches for hot stamp technology for GM, Ford, Brosa, Chrysler, you know, the big threes and other companies there. And then was had the good fortune of working with Chrysler. At that time, it was Daimler Chrysler. Then it was Chrysler Corporation, and then it was Fiat Chrysler, and now it is Stellantis. So I did work there in a very niche group called Dimensional Engineering, and I was on the global supplier quality engineer for the JS49 program. Then I did move from Chrysler to John Deere, another big company and another different domain, which is non-automotive. And I was a global supplier quality engineer on a diverse program, international one, which was with South Africa and London. And we had a product mix, which was launched articulated dump trucks by Bell South Africa into the US. And then there was Loaders, which was a John Deere product launched into South Africa under the name Bell. So did have a good experience with global teams working, you know, across geographies. And then back in 2010, I had the opportunity of going back and kind of exploring options in India, in my hometown. And that is where I'm a second generation Tata Motor. So did get an opportunity to work with Tata Technologies for leading their Tata Motors Lucknow plant. And then did the Lucknow plant, the Pune plant, which is the car plant, Indiga plant, and then the most complex of all plants, the Tata Motors CVBU plant, where I was the face of IT, the plant CIO kind of role, managing infrastructure and application development. And then moved back to the UK in 2016 to grow Tata Technologies' value proposition in Europe and North America. But at that time is when this buzz of Industry 4.0 was picking up, and that is what I kind of picked up. And that's what I do for a living right now. I'm very passionate about this area because I've seen the company inside out. And with digital Industry 4.0, it's the most happening field in terms of digitalization and a big agenda on the CXO table. So that's a little bit about me.
Wow, that is an illustrious experience that you touched upon there with the right mix of technology orientation and also about half of the time on the manufacturing side. So you have been on the both side of the table. So Sam, in the introduction, Naveen briefly touched upon the evolution of Industrial 1.0 that, you know, the steam engine started after the 2.0, 3.0 to current 4.0. So can you please explain a bit about this evolution and also what this Industry 4.0 is more about? What are the advantages?
So while the question appears to be simplistic, we could talk about this for hours together and days together. So to put it in perspective, Industry 4 and the topic of our podcast, Industry 4 Digital Smart Manufacturing. So there are two distinct domains. Industry 4 is all about strategy. It's not about technology. Okay, to put it in perspective. And digital smart manufacturing is enabling technology to implement Industry 4.0. So Industry 4.0 is basically driven by business outcomes. And to put it in perspective of the evolution part, so way back in 1784, you had the steam engine by Watt, right? In the UK, right? That is when your mechanization started as the first revolution. Then came kind of electrification in 1913 kind of time, where you have the second revolution, which is called electrical energy. Then comes the digitalization, which is the third, you know, revolution, which is fossils energy. And then comes cyber physical systems, which is what we are talking about, the fourth industrial revolution, which is sustainable energy. So while 1784 to the third revolution, you can say is pretty much linear innovation, anything after 2013, where you get the Industry 4 cyber physical systems is exponential innovation. And I'll get to that if we have the time. But you know, if you look at digital as a word, there is a lot in the digital world where you have Uber as the largest taxi company, Skype as the largest phone company, but no, it does not own any telco infrastructure. You know, you have Alibaba as the most valuable retailer, but has no inventory on that end. Netflix, the largest movie house with no cinemas. So that's digital. But my topic is Industry 4.0, which is specific to production, optimizing production, reducing costs and making more profits for the automotive slash manufacturing companies who are on this curve of getting more smart, right? So I think so that is succinctly put on what the evolution of 1 to 4 is and where we are right now.
That's great summary, Sam. And you mentioned about manufacturing has become smart or smarter, I would say. And how do you think this smart manufacturing is going to help businesses?
So yeah, so that's the $1 million question, right? So just to put it in perspective, if you look at the journey on which manufacturers globally are, right? Be it automotive or non-automotive, aerospace, whatever. Anybody who has a manufacturing plant is the customer in focus, right? So today, since the Internet of Things, like it is the connected enterprise. And if you have things connected, then you can have data generated. And if you have data generated, then you would have insights into that data. And if you have insights into that data, guess what? You can make better decisions. So on this journey of smart manufacturing, pretty much everything is disconnected on an ISA 95 stack, which is level 1, level 2, level 3, and level 4. With that, with smart manufacturing on a scale of 1 to 10, the companies are pretty much on a 2 or a 3. And the people and the companies which are very much ahead of this curve are pretty much Germans and France and Germany. And then you have the other companies which are following suit with UK and US kind of falling behind. Smart manufacturing is to getting more bang for the buck, if I can say so. And that is by building a connected enterprise using digital technology.
Wonderful. I think this is going to revolutionize the way manufacturing is going to happen, and it will lead to significant cost reduction from the company's perspective, and which ultimately will pass on to the customers as well, hopefully, right?
Absolutely. End of the day, anything and everything that you do in technology has to benefit the end customer.
Absolutely.
So we did some programs where you are common life cycle to build a car, design a car, and then launch it is pretty much 36 months. Now we are using a lot of digital technology, smart manufacturing. You know, I would like to get into the whole life cycle of what I'm trying to talk about smart manufacturing. It starts with design, PLM, MES, ERP, and then manufacturing. But for the paucity of time, we could reduce the product life cycle time for one of the biggest manufacturers to 22 months. So we have saved 14 months.
Yeah.
We saved a lot of cost. We saved a lot of time. But the customer that's going to benefit is going to bring the product to market faster than anybody else. So guess what? He's going to capture more market, right? So
yep.
Everything and anything that you do in technology cannot be by itself. It has to benefit the end user, the end customer, right?
Absolutely.
So that's the benefit of technology.
Very well put through. And Sam, this Industry 4.0, it is also called as Industrial IoT, right? So
yep.
Industrial Internet of Things. And how is this IoT, okay,
yes.
helping the Industry 4.0? And what is
sure. it? It's better if I give you an analogy, which is easy to understand. Because technology in which ways is difficult to grasp, less better understood, typically to understand, right? implement. So if you look at your house, right, back in the days, growing up, we did have a house, we did have a television, we did have a fridge, we had TV, microwave, everything, right? And now we have broadband coming into our lives, right? So everything is connected. So we do digital calls, we do WhatsApp calls, we do, portal Facebook, we have apps for everything. So what has happened is we really don't need to be in the house to do what we need to do in the house. You have the Ring doorbell connected to the net, and that is where you can check on, if you're in the office, somebody's visiting your house, you can know who's come at your off at the door, you can give them access, they can keep stuff, they can leave, right? So coming to the point in the analogies, since everything is connected, similarly in the manufacturing world also, there were mechanical machines on a manufacturing shop floor, and those used to do the production of components or the cars or the product, right? But these were done in silos, and it would not be connected with the enterprise. So when I say connected with the enterprise, I will introduce another technological term called ERP. So most of the ERPs basically is where your orders are generated and they are fed down through to the manufacturing shop floor. And again, there's another technology called manufacturing execution systems, which accepts that order, plans the production for the day. And through MES, we understand what product we are going to build, how much we are going to build, and what production tag times and all that kind of stuff. And once that is done, we book those orders again in SAP. So the loop goes downstream and upstream from ERP to MES and from MES to ERP, where order booking is done. And then it's connected to the CRM side of things, where you kind of start shipping your products to dealers and all that kind of network. So Internet of Things enables this connectivity of a product across business processes to leverage the outcome of building better products, quicker products, and delivering ahead of time. That visibility that you can get into a manufacturing enterprise for a company that might have one plant, or let's go with small to big, it might have one manufacturing line. It might have 10 manufacturing lines in a plant. It might have multiple plants with multiple manufacturing lines. And if you wanted to standardize all those manufacturing lines across the globe, across one parameter, say, for example, which is the biggest one that is taken now, is overall equipment efficiency that measures the productivity of a line in a plant across country, across a geography, then you need everything to be connected to make a decision. And that is what Internet of Things enables, with sensors, where machines are enabled with sensors and data translation happens from subsystems between each other to understand business process imperatives to take decisions. I know it's a little bit less easier to understand, but in context, that is what it is, a connected enterprise to make good decisions.
Wow, amazing, Sam. So you talked about enterprise resource planning, ERP, MES, supply chain management, SCM, Internet of Things, IoT, edge computing, and thereby, taking care of overall equipment efficiency.
Sure.
Thank you.
Yeah.
So Sam, for Industry 4.0,
yeah.
These many subsystems are working together in collaboration
yeah.
to make it work.
Yeah.
So that itself is mouthful and too many things. So what after Industry 4.0? Is there a 5.0 and 6.0 waiting for us already?
What's your guess?
Should be. Like Naveen said, something in 1784, 89, wherever we started that steam engine 1.0 to current 2021 4.0, there should be something in pipeline for Industry 5.0 and Industry 6.0. Something similar to 5G and 6G, right?
Yeah, so I should have talked about a dedication. So Hendrik von Scheele, who is kind of the guru and the founder of and the person who has coined this term Industry 4.0, right? And I've been talking to him off and on for a long time. So he says the fourth industrial revolution alters every aspect of our lives, our economy, how we live, consume, work, and relate to one another, right? Unlike anything humankind has experienced before. So actually, it is not what after Industry 4, what's next. It is basically going to be meaning as Industry X.0 with exponential innovation, right? And I'll just touch upon a little bit, not too much again, because this topic is very, very big. But the first wave typically is 2009 to 2016, where you have digitalization in the current time, right? Digitalization, advanced analytics, cloud computing, this, that, and the other. Then the second wave is 2016, 2025, with artificial intelligence taking precedence, autonomous systems, blockchain, smart automation, 6G communication, stuff like that. And the third wave is kind of where your question comes from, is 2025. And 2025 will see, you know, quantum technology, cybersecurity, neurotechnology, nanotechnology, bioinformatics, advanced material. And God, let me tell you, if we still live that time, we will be blessed, because we're going to see so much of disruption that even we cannot fathom to even understand what's going on. So my niche is smart manufacturing, but this is what it is on a canvas, right? Digital disruption is going to be crazy. So I don't know if you understand what I'm trying to say. But after Industry 4 is going to be Industry X.0 is my take on it.
So things are going to be furthermore crazier than where we are is what I got it from this whole conversation.
It is. It's going to be difficult to fathom and even have a hang or a handle on what disruption is going on in which part of the world, purely because of the internet, right? So
absolutely. And future seems to be very, very exciting. And really look forward, maybe how things are going to shape up in next 10 to 15 years. So very excited about.
My thing is the utopian world where robots should do all the work that needs to be done and people should not work and government should, because any which is you're going to make products using robots and cobots and all these kind of good stuff. People don't need to work and governments can actually give us a free check every month just to enjoy our lives. That's
and make us further lazy.
Yeah, you would say lazy, you would explore. You might want to pursue mountaineering, you want to do skydiving, you want to go deep sea diving, whatever, right? There is, we are held back to pursue our hobbies because we need to earn a living, right? Mm-hmm. Not to say that we don't do that. We have vacations, but that, and this is a fact with Switzerland, they are always excess in their incomes versus spends. And they go back to the people of the country and they ask them, what do you do with the extra money we have? So the people of Switzerland say that you don't give it back to us. They were ready to give back everybody some amount, but they say, no, you invest in new technology. So I think so. Technology should be looked in a positive view that it can actually make everybody self-sufficient in terms of what we need to, for our lives. But at the same time, you don't need to work, right? Farmers used to plow fields and produce food grain. Do you need that if you have drones and robots doing it now, right? But still, you can benefit from food grains. You don't need to work. So you can do 10 things more. You can do more research. Instead of 10% research, 90% implementation, you might go the other way around. Yep. You can do 90% research because everything else automated is taken care of by robots, right? So I see technology as a boon, not as a, this thing. So that's my take, but.
No, absolutely. Like, this is a wonderful perspective and looking at, and I really came across this Switzerland stuff for the first time. So thanks for sharing that as well. And Sam, this conversation has been fabulous so far, and let's try to spice it up further with a quick rapid fire round. Are you ready for a...
Always on, always on. Get it on.
Bring it on.
Wonderful, wonderful. So let's get started with the first bullet from the rapid fire. What are your pet peeves?
The pet peeves, if I want to say, I should be able to distance myself from the pet visa, but putting it in perspective for an answer... Dishonesty and not being realistic and people with prejudices. Dishonesty very big on my chart. I really get turned off with dishonesty and people who are dishonest.
Fair enough. Yeah. Moving on to the next one. What is your favorite failure?
See, this word is interesting, right? It has a negative connotation. And when you brought this question up, it kind of struck me. Why would you call it failure, right? Because there is a personal loss in it in some way. But if you call it learnings, it is more positive, right? So I've learned through all my failures, each failure is a beautiful failure. Because if you don't have a failure, you would not know what success is, right? So,
and you will not enjoy it.
You will not enjoy it, absolutely. And you get the best only when you are put against in a tough situation, right? That is where you actually start thinking, right? So I think so, learnings is a better word. But yeah, all failures have been great.
Wonderful. Yeah, here comes a very apt question for an Industry 4.0 expert. what according to you was the best invention in the last 50 years?
See, now you guys also are from the IT domain, right? So you should change it to what is the best innovation in the last 5 years? That should be where you should guys be now, right? Because 50 years is like donkey's years, right? What is the last 5 days? What was the best invention? But jokes apart, I think so, hands down, internet for me, because it has absolutely transformed and changed our lives inside out. And you know, everything and anything that we are doing today also is because of internet, right? And that for me is the best invention possibly that I can put my finger on.
I concur with you. And the other day I was going through an article about how this internet was created, and they never imagined that it would last for this long. Okay. And however, there has been a lot of revolution, and it's actually changing the face of everything, right?
Yeah, it's the spine of everything that we're doing right now, right? If that was not there, I don't think so. The Facebooks would be there, you know, the electric cars, everything is based on the net, right? Broadband, fiber, everything. So
we would not have this conversation.
You would have missed out on a fantastic person to be viewed on this planet Earth.
Absolutely.
Very true. Very true. So another interesting question, Sam. Imagine like if you could build a product, okay, with unlimited funding and no resource constraints, etc., right? Yeah. What would it be?
See, I have education very close to my heart, right? Mm-hmm. So I think if you're talking about unlimited funding, the best one would be education, an online platform. Everything is online, because I am associated with one of the companies, one of the nonprofit in India, and it's run by a lawyer, Hari Om Jindal. And I don't mind taking his name, because he's a lawyer by profession, but he's built 13 slum schools on his own, mm-hmm. and actually taking people out of slums, kids out of slums, so that they don't go a street begging, and they don't go a street doing stuff which, you know, you should not be doing at that age. And he brings them into a jhukki jhopadi, that we call in Hindi, right? A small slum school, and he educates them. So I think so, if you give them access to free education, well, that is what one needs. Once you know, teach a person to give a person a fish and he'll eat for a day, and teach him to fish and he'll eat for a lifetime, right? So I think so, if you give access to education, they will learn. And once they learn, they have a mind of their own. They will know how to get a living. So I think so, that would be the best possible, you know, project that I would like to run. It should be scalable globally. So not a single person or not a single child who does not have access to education should have one, as simple as that, you know, and it'll change lives. For sure.
I completely echo with your statement. Teach a man how to fish, because that makes them self-sustained and they can move on. They can be independent. Absolutely. Wonderful. Absolutely. Wonderful. So here comes my last question for the rapid fire. And the question is, have you ever saved money to buy something you wanted? And what was it?
That is very, very much of a capitalist type of question, right? Have you saved money for yourself? Well, that is not really what life is all about. Yeah. It has to be, you know, I'm a Gemini with number 8, so I'm extremes. And I say that because I've realized that about myself in my journey of self-realization, right? So I've been there, done that with a lot of money, but now it is the other way around, where I think so, I don't need to spend, I don't need anything for myself, but it is more about transcending inwards and not outwards. And when you transcend inwards, it's more about the Sanatan Dharma that we talk of, Ekam Satya, right? So the basic principle of life is Sat Chit Ananda, right? That really does not gel with the question that you asked me. So I don't have anything to say. It's all about my journey to explore my inner, happiness and live a happy life. That's pretty much it.
I think a lot of stuff that you spoke is connecting with me in some way or the other. Right? Recently, I've gone through this 21 days abundance course with Deepak Chopra, and I came across this Sat Chit Ananda, and it was very fabulous, mind-blowing. And
Deepak Chopra is a nice soul, but he packages it for the West.
Yeah.
But what is the origin of Sanatan Dharma? I don't need to tell you that.
Absolutely.
We need to go back to our roots. Great. And there is abundance for us to gain there. We don't need something else. But the only thing is, Sanskrit is the language of the gods, and we don't speak that language today, which is our own. Sat Chit Ananda is a Sanskrit word.
Yeah.
Tattvamasi is a Sanskrit word. And Tattvamasi is about consciousness. So that's a long topic. You'll have to do another guiding voice with me for that.
Yeah, good. Great rapid fire so far. And thanks for being so sportive. And over to you, Sudhakar.
Excellent. After that amazing rapid fire, one final question for this session, Sam.
Yeah.
I'm sure you have more than one, but what is one piece of advice that you want to give to those aspiring to make big in their careers? Definitely, like you said, need not be materialistic, but from overall life enjoyment perspective.
Who am I to advise? But I can only suggest and put things in perspective, and then it's for them to pick and choose. But I think so, making it big in life should never be the goal. It should be an outcome, right? And because when I look at myself today, I'm a 45. If I look at when I was 22 and then put it in perspective, I think so, there has to be an understanding of what you're good at. And if you're good at You need to work hard at it. And irrespective, whatever you like, because everybody is blessed with one innate quality which they're good at. Not everybody's an engineer or a doctor or, you know, a sportsman, but they are blessed with something unique. If they find that uniqueness in them and then build over it, you know, they're any which way is going to be the best at what they do in time to come. And that is becoming, you know, that is the outcome of making it big. Nobody starts with an intention, I'm going to make it big today or someday, right? So I think so. Whatever they do, they should be very passionate about what they do. And one thing which I would like to add is add a quality of empathy and humility in all that you do and how you, you know, interact with people around you, because that will, the day you make it big successfully, you will not be only successful, but you will be happy also. And that will make you feel complete if you add empathy. So that's my two cents, not somebody to advise anybody, but that's what my view is.
Excellent. Sam, this has been a phenomenal discussion. Loved every bit of it. Thank you so much for joining us today. It was indeed great experience to talk to you about Industry 4.0 digital smart manufacturing, but life at large. I will leave with that one thing that you said, identify and accept your uniqueness and build on it. Thank you so much, Sam. It was our pleasure.
Sudhakar and Naveen, it was destiny that our roads would cross paths. And through this also, if you look at the unspoken truth, there will be many people who might benefit from this. They might get some ideas. They might get some motivation, some inspiration. You really never know why we do this and why you are doing it or why I'm doing it, right? We've not known people for a long time, but there is always a hidden answer in everything. And that's for people who are searching for that. So thank you so much. It has been fantastic. As I said, passionate about Industry 4. By choice, I picked it up. I'm not a techie. I'm more on the sales side, but I love this field. And it was a pleasure talking to you guys and wish you all the success in all your TGV podcasts now and future. Thanks a lot.
Thanks again, Sam. It was a super conversation, I would say. And it was absolutely great pleasure hosting you.
My pleasure, mate.
All right. So it brings us to the trivia segment of today's episode. And today's trivia is about computer virus. So folks, do you know what was the first ever computer virus? I know you might be thinking, but let me reveal the answer as per the ritual. Creeper, okay, which was written by Mr. Bob Thomas in 1971, is the first ever computer virus. Interesting, isn't it? Thank you for listening. There is more in store, folks. Stay tuned. Take care. Be safe. Until next time. Bye-bye. And we are signing off for today. See you all in the next episode.